May it please the court, my name is Paul Prather. I'm here as counsel for Terminix International and Ernest Walker. Case is pretty well briefed, and I sense the court reads the briefs, so I'll try not to restate much of what's there. What I think this is a novel issue. At least I couldn't find this issue being decided in the jurisprudence of this court, but it involves a fairly straightforward application of the principles that were set forth in the opinion of the other Judge Fletcher in Countrywide Home versus Mortgage Guarantee. And the issue there being the discretion of a judge to dismiss under 41A2 an opposed dismissal when a motion to compel arbitration is pending. And in the Countrywide case, it didn't involve 41A2. It involved a remand under the Declaratory Judgment Act, so it's different, but that was discretionary in very much the same way. And I think...
Well, it's both, but discretion covers a lot of territory, and declaratory judgment versus 41, those are very different questions.
Well, they are different, and in fact, I'm not sure whether one has more than the other, but I'll concede that they're different. But this all harkens back, and Judge Fletcher harkened back to Judge Marshall's opinion back in Dean Witter, where we were talking about the discretion of a court in the face of an arbitration motion to apply the intertwining doctrine, which existed in about three circuits, including this one, and the Supreme Court rejected that.
Intertwining doctrine under?
Yeah, there was a doctrine that existed back before 1984 when Dean Witter was decided, that where you had both arbitral and non-arbitral claims, and they were so intertwined, the thinking was that at least in three circuits followed this rule, that including the Ninth Circuit, that you could, in the discretion of the court, refuse to send the claims to arbitration because of the complexity of dealing with some claims in arbitration and some not. Some circuit, it was a split in the circuit, and that was resolved by Judge Marshall's opinion. But what is important from Judge Marshall's opinion, I encourage you to go back and read it if you haven't, is he talked about the fact that the FAA robs the district judge of discretion. And it's important to look at the language. When this came to my attention, I went back and read Section 3 of the statute says, uses the word shall stay. Section 4.
Now, what's interesting about that is it also says that the district court, upon being satisfied that the issue involved in such suit or proceeding is referable to arbitration under such an agreement. And as I understand this case, there was one claim at the time, right? And
it
was
PAGA claim.
The PAGA right. claim. And at that time, it was pending before the question of whether you could waive right to trial by jury for a PAGA claim in California was pending before the California...
The Canadian decision was pending before the California
right.
Supreme Court
and,
at that time.
And then correct. The California Supreme Court came out and ruled that it was not. And so at the time that she dismissed the PAGA case instead of referring it to arbitration, the district judge couldn't be satisfied that it was referable under California law. It's a California statute.
And this is what's so very important about the process that happened. She didn't rule on it. She said it was moot. She allowed the dismissal and ruled that it was moot. So had she ruled on it, in fact, this is where the distinction becomes very important. Had she ruled on what? On the motion to compel arbitration. She said it was moot by the dismissal. And so had she ruled on that, then Terminix and Mr. Walker would have had
dropped a footnote saying, explaining exactly why she couldn't rule on it. She said, in the absence of the above reference dismissal, the court would find it appropriate to defer ruling on defendant's motion pending the California Supreme Court's decision in Iskanian.
And so she might have waited and done nothing with it had she not dismissed.
But I guess practically speaking now, you want us to send it back to the district court, and I'm just trying to figure out why should we force the district court to decide the arbitrability of a claim that is plainly now not arbitral.
Well,
because not only has California weighed in, but the Ninth Circuit has
absolutely.
Weighed in.
Absolutely. In
fact, and said...
We have the opinion of Judge Mylan Smith and the contrary opinion of Judge N.R. Smith.
Well, it's a dissent.
A district judge from Illinois, Judge Lefkow, who was a part of the majority there, and we have a pending...
Does that matter to you? I mean, I don't understand what's the precedent here is... Is is the fact that that case was decided by a majority. I mean,
It's binding authority, Judge. I'm not arguing that. But my point is there's now a pending a motion for en banc review that was filed in the middle of the last month on that. So we haven't finished writing the story about that.
I appreciate that. But as of right now, if this went back, to what end is what I'm trying to figure out.
I would say the judge would have two choices right now, today. If you remand this case, as I think you should.
And well,
she
we have
do,
a choice
well,
now.
Well, I understand. But if you remand it, then as I'm asking you to do, then the judge would have two choices. She could follow that precedent or wait or put it on hold as she was going to do for the scanning and wait to see what happens on the en banc review from the
Well, you
court.
Know, here, let me go at this a different way, and I won't talk about arbitration until the very end. So we have a complaint that's filed in state court that includes a PAGA claim, but other claims that are subject to CAFA.
Right.
It's removed based on CAFA.
Right.
Plaintiff says, I don't want to be here, and tries to get says, okay, I'm not going to pursue the CAFA claims.
Doesn't dismiss and, the whole thing.
I'm telling the story, and You can respond after I've told the story.
I'm sorry, Your Honor.
And then you can agree or disagree. Okay, so now the plaintiff says, all I've got left is the PAGA claim, and I want a remand. And the district judge says, I think correctly, sorry, post-removal amendments don't necessarily get you a remand. So he says, well, in that case, I just want to dismiss. Now, if there weren't an FAA claim in here, I see absolutely no impediment to a dismissal at that point.
I will beg to disagree on that. And the one of the other points, see, what happened is...
Okay, so why do you disagree? Excuse me, let me just ask the question. So you're saying that when somebody is in federal court with a claim that is now not subject to remand, the district judge lacks discretion to allow voluntary dismissal?
No, I don't. That's saying lacks discretion. I think what the judge should have done is allowed a response to be filed, which was due in 14 days, rather than rule in 2 days. And in that response, the argument would have been, the argument that's made in the papers here, would have been there's prejudice by the forum shopping that's going on here.
But isn't that the pot calling the kettle black? I mean,
well, perhaps.
Because you were forum shopping when you removed it to federal court in the first place.
Congress gave the right
I
to
realize
do that.
That, but you were doing you want it in federal court, and they want it in state court. So.
Right. I mean, you have the right to do that. But if you look at some of the cases, and instructive.
If I could ask you a question.
Sure.
And that's the Morris case, the Morris case. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm trying to figure out how this fits in here, but it seems to me that stands for the proposition that the district court can still grant Rule 41 dismissals, not remands, but dismissals, despite the pendency of arbitration matters. It seems like that's even a more drastic step to me to dismiss once a case is in arbitration than what happened here. So if you could address that.
Sure. In Morris, the case went to arbitration. The plaintiff didn't prosecute it. And after a period of time, it was dismissed not under 41A2, but under 41B.
I know, but still a 41 dismissal.
Right, but I think it's different. And I think a court, after when it extends a case to arbitration, under the jurisprudence of this court, retains jurisdiction over the case. And the failure to prosecute under 41B would seem to be appropriate. And I'm not sure that case... It doesn't mean that the court couldn't dismiss this case, Your Honor. What the court should have done is rule on the motion to compel, either if she sent it to arbitration, then it goes to arbitration. If she denies it, then the second step that should have occurred here would have been a ruling with reasons, which we have none of here, and in terms of the reason for the dismissal.
But why, I mean, I don't think we encourage courts, or we're not encouraged to rule on things that we don't have to. And if there's a dismissal, a motion for dismissal, I mean, saying, I just want out of this, not I want to go back to the state court or the motion to remand. I'm just trying to figure out, policy-wise, why we wouldn't do it. And then it seems to me that Morris is a more egregious case, I guess, in terms of, in that case, it's precedent saying, hey, a district court can dismiss a case once it's in arbitration. I know that there was a lack, but it's actually in arbitration. So I'm trying to figure out why, if Morris is good law and precedent and binding, then why wouldn't we follow that?
I think there's two questions there, or at least I'm going to answer them as two questions, Your Honor. And the first one is the why have to. And the have to goes to the compulsory nature of the FAA. The court, in fact, it says shall stay, shall hear the parties, shall have a expedited process to determine if there's an agreement that's enforceable between the parties. And then what's important about all that is if the court rules on it, then the appeal of that ruling, which is of right, if it's denied, is a de novo appeal, not an appeal as a matter of discretion. So that's where there's real harm here. And that's this. Now, as
but
to
what's the, as, what it, I guess, why is the harm when it's a dismissal? You've got me if it's a motion to remand, but I'm just having a little trouble when it's a motion to dismiss.
Well, the
under 41.
That's right. It's the reason here is the court jumps the gun and grants the ruling without a response and without ruling on the motion to compel arbitration, which I believe the court was required to do that first and foremost. Under that, and for instance, in Morris, the court had already sent the case to arbitration. It was just retained jurisdiction. So if you're not proceeding, I'm taking it back and I'm tossing you out, which I have no disagreement. It just doesn't have an application in my mind to this particular set of facts.
Let me ask the question in a different way. Now, putting to one side the Rule 41, let's assume that we had a straightforward filing in federal court.
Mm-hmm.
Motion for arbitration.
Right.
Plaintiff then files a 41 motion and says, I want to take a voluntary dismissal. Is there anything that prevents the district judge from dismissing?
Not a thing. In fact, that's exactly the case.
Why is this case different merely because it was removed?
Well, I mean, there's nothing that you have to rule on the motion to compel first, is what I'm saying.
Maybe you misunderstood the question and didn't answer the way you wanted to. Because I'm asking you, okay, filing in federal court,
right.
Defendant makes a motion to compel arbitration. Plaintiff makes a motion under Rule 41 for dismissal. What's to prevent the district judge from not ruling on the FAA motion but just dismissing?
I don't think the judge can do that. If there's been an answer or summary judgment motion, which gets us to 41.
I'm assuming we're under 41B.
Right. So we're under 41A2.
I think you can't
do that. And
do you have a case?
Because of exactly the language in Countrywide, there's no discretion.
I don't
about
think Countrywide
taking
controls
taking
this one. Yeah. Okay.
I think that's
if
the.
If you're relying on Countrywide, I don't think it gets you there.
Okay. Well, that's...
You've got any other case?
That's the only case that has... I mean, it comes from the Dean Witter precedent, but that is the precedent, and I think the rationale
If that's all you got, I think we're doing some open field running here.
Well, it's a novel issue. I'll concede that as well.
Okay.
Thank you, Your Honor. I'm going to reserve my last 2 minutes,
right.
If I may, Your Honor.
Thank you.
May it please the Court, Your Honor. My name is Larry Lee. I represent the plaintiff and appellee. My argument is going to be short. I think Your Honors have fleshed out most of the issues. What I do want to address is this prejudice argument that has been significantly briefed by the appellant and that wasn't really addressed. And the reason being, there is no more prejudice at this point.
Also, didn't they address prejudice in their reply on the motion to compel arbitration?
Yes.
Didn't they argue that your motion for voluntary dismissal shouldn't be granted?
And here's the reason why the appellant asked that, because at the time they did that, some district courts were not complying with Iskanian, with California Supreme Court's Iskanian ruling. Some district courts said, we're not going to agree with that. We think the opposite. And so the appellant at that time wanted the district court, in our case, to rule on it, hoping that they would rule the same way as some other district courts in refusing to adopt Iskanian. And that's the harm that they are saying they suffer, because they didn't get that very opportunity to make that argument. Well, 2 months ago, Your Honor, the Ninth Circuit issued its ruling in Sakab versus Luxottica. That's 803 F3rd 425. And that was on September 28, 2015. In that case, the Ninth Circuit finally adopted Iskanian and said Iskanian is not the law of this circuit. So that entire argument of hoping the district court would refuse to comply with Iskanian is out the window now. If we go back, like you said, what happens if we go back?
Yeah, I understand that, but I'll tell you, I'm troubled by this case. I mean, this is a really unusual and novel situation because... Countrywide and all the other authority regarding the arbitration makes it pretty clear and is becoming increasingly more clear that, you know, the district courts especially have less and less discretion and have to decide these arbitrary motion to compels. Because the way I read the plain terms of Section 3 is that a district court has to reach the merits of an arbitration motion before it can exercise its discretion to get rid of the case. And I'm looking at the Federal Arbitration Act that says leaves no place for the exercise, or this was the Dean Witter case where the Supreme Court says the Federal Arbitration Act leaves no place for the exercise of discretion by a district court, but instead mandates that the district courts shall direct the parties to proceed to arbitration on issues to which an arbitration agreement has been signed. And then we said in Countrywide that the express terms of the statute do not allow a district court to abstain from granting relief in cases where its jurisdiction is proper. And the jurisdiction here was proper. And then it also, if we look to Section 3, it says it requires a federal court to decide an FAA motion that is properly before it. So I'm just trying to figure out why, with all this authority, why wasn't the district court required to rule on the motion to compel?
I would argue, Your Honor, that the difference is in those cases, the claims were subject. The arbitration agreement was enforceable. The claims were subject to the FAA. This is a PAGA case. The Ninth Circuit has already stated
that. No, but it was an FAA. If it was a question about the arbitration before. I know it's a PAGA case, but there was a clause, apparently, that was being disputed. I mean, that's the whole purpose of the reason why you dropped the class action, wasn't it?
Correct, Your Honor.
All right. So once that happened, why wasn't the district court required, based on all of this authority, to rule on the motion to compel?
Well, I think the district court has a discretion. I don't disagree that the district court could have considered the motion to compel arbitration before granting dismissal. That's certainly within its discretion. But I think at the same time, district court also has discretion to say, you know what, I'm going to dismiss it. I'm not going to make any sort of substantive rulings before I dismiss it. I think that's within the district court's discretion.
What's your best authority?
It's the Morris case.
But in Morris, they had gone to arbitration, so there was no issue about ruling on the motion to compel.
That's correct, Your Honor.
So that's a little bit different than here.
But
because the defendants or the other party had their the ability to have their case, you know, go to arbitration. The problem was that there was a failure to prosecute down in arbitration. So I'm struggling a little bit.
Your Honor, in Morris, the court had compelled arbitration. So the court could have said, I don't have discretion anymore. I've compelled arbitration. It should be in the arbitrator's discretion to decide. But the court didn't say that. It said, no, the court still has discretion to decide whether to dismiss this.
I know, point is, though, that the other side in Morris had the ability to have their case go to arbitration. The motion to compel had been ruled on.
Right.
So there's, in some way you look at it, less harm to them in that case, because it's like, well, we tried and we had the ability. We were not denied the opportunity to have our case arbitrated.
I hear what Your Honor is saying. There's not a case directly on point on this very issue. It is sort of a novel issue. What I would say, again, going back, is, like, if we could do that, this court could remand it and ask the court to make the decision. But let's look at what would happen in that case. We would be at this very same place. The court would simply deny it based upon the recent Sakha versus Lexotica matter, and we'd be sitting in court. There would be no arbitration. So, quite frankly, I think it would be sort of an inefficient wasting our time to do that.
Did your original state court complaint also include a PAGA claim?
I'm sorry, Your Honor.
Did your original state court complaint include a PAGA claim?
Yes.
And class action?
Yes.
All right. And I suppose now people aren't doing that anymore in California, right?
No, I still do it. people still do it.
If you want to be in state court, you're making yourself subject to CAFA, and then you're making yourself vulnerable to a motion to compel for arbitration.
Well, I would say a lot of times, you know, plaintiffs don't know if there's an arbitration agreement. A lot of times plaintiffs don't recall if they ever signed an arbitration agreement. That's just a risk, you know, we all have
to take. That's something you should figure out before you file the complaint.
Well, a lot of times that we don't get the sufficient. But let me go back to respond, Your Honor. There really isn't no risk at this point because of the Sakab case that has come down.
I know, but the other side of that argument is that we might go en banc on this other one, and we might say that we don't apply that case in federal court. But, you know, that's all very speculative, of course. But we're almost in the same position that the district court judge was. She didn't want to rule because she knew that the California Supreme Court was going to say whether or not this had to be pretty soon. She knew that. And she didn't want to send it to arbitration if it was going to be determined that it was not subject to arbitration.
Correct.
So it's pretty unique circumstances here.
Correct, Your Honor.
Can we affirm on a different ground and say, well, now that we know not only what the California rule is, but that the Ninth Circuit has agreed with the rule?
That was going to be my other statement, too. Yes, you could affirm.
Whether or not she had the power as the law then existed,
right,
to dismiss under 41 A2, she clearly would have the power now.
Correct.
Given that the law is now established in the Ninth Circuit.
Correct, Your Honor. That's what's going to be my next statement is you could simply do that here. Because again, going back would have the same result.
What do you do with the possibility that we might go en banc, that the Supreme Court might take the case, reverse? I mean, you know, I don't regard the PAGA decision by the California Supreme Court as invulnerable to reversal by the United States Supreme Court. The record of the California Supreme Court in arbitration cases resembles the record of the Ninth Circuit in criminal cases.
Well, let me say
habeas cases, I should say.
I am confident that nothing will change, and here's why. The Iskanian ruling has already been petitioned for cert before the U.S. Supreme Court from the state venue to U.S. directly twice, and both times the U.S. Supreme Court has rejected cert. So we're confident the U.S. Supreme Court has indicated, let Iskanian stand, that we're not going to touch it. So we don't think that en banc is going to change.
So I hear that the chances are diminishing.
Correct, Your Honor. I have nothing further unless Your Honor have any other questions.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
A couple of more points, if I might, Your Honor. At the time, Iskanian hadn't been decided, but even post-Iskanian, I think the overwhelming majority of the district judges in the state rejected Iskanian and sent the PAGA claims to arbitration. So Sakab was a significant turn in at least where the law was at the district court level, and there's a number of those cases cited. It's not important at the moment in the sense, but here's what really could happen here. If it goes back on remand, the judge, as I said, either denies or I don't think she can grant arbitration at this point because Sakab is binding authority. So she either denies the arbitration, in which case my client then has under Section 16 a de novo right of appeal and may want to pursue that to preserve its rights and to see what happens on the en banc or possibly the Supreme Court, because I'm not so confident Mr. Lee's right that the Supreme Court's not going to get interested in that. They only seem to take up two at a time, and they have two California arbitration cases up at the moment. But even if the arbitration is denied, the judge did not give us any reasons as to why dismissal was granted, because one of the harm there that's raised by several of the cases, the Kern decision, the Roy Obb decision, which was in the briefs, is the deprivation of federal forum. And frankly, the PAGA claim could proceed in court in a federal forum as well as it could in state forum, and my clients had the right to select that and selected it correctly on the front end.
But if the argument, the argument you've been so far pursuing is that the district judge erred because she didn't have the right to make a 41 ruling in the face of a request for arbitration.
Right.
That now is gone.
Well,
so you're now saying your client has a right to proceed on the PAGA claim, quite aside from that. That takes us into absolutely standard territory for a Rule 41 motion.
Well, you're right. The problem is, as was briefed in the briefs, is you have no rulings in what would have been an opposed motion. I mean, the footnote
an opposed motion on the arbitration point at this point is frivolous,
no,
unless you're trying to appeal it.
I'm not communicating well with you. When Terminix filed its response, its reply motion in support of its motion to compel, it was the same day the plaintiff moved to dismiss and said in there, you know, don't dismiss. You know, there's prejudice. It's forum shopping, and we want more time for briefing. And under the local rules, they would have had 14 days to respond to the motion to dismiss. The judge acted in 2 days without any reasons, just granted the motion. And had my client been permitted to respond under the rules, as it should have been under the local rules, then the question before the district judge in her discretion, I agree, would be whether or not forum shopping is a legitimate reason to deny the request. And there's a number of cases cited in the briefs where that, in fact, is the issue. One of them was an old case from the Ninth Circuit where, you know, trying to shop between multiple judges was a basis to deny a Rule 41-2 motion to dismiss. So I think the judge just jumped the gun here. Going back, I'm not going to predict what happens, but my client was prejudiced by the fact that their motion to compel wasn't ruled on, which prejudices their rights of appeal under Section 16 of the FAA, which would be a de novo right to appeal, and we never got that ruling because the judge did exactly what Judge Fletcher said you can't do, and that is you can't exercise discretion in the face of the FAA. You just don't have discretion.
All right. Thank you, counsel.
Thank you very much.
You've gone over your time. Rivas versus Terminix is submitted. We will take up Barrow versus Lipetsky.